sent my son in the book of 1 Peter. And so 1 Peter says, number one, and I can't wait to get to you. You can say anything and somebody else is hearing. But 1 Peter says, number one, I want you to be ready to pray together just a little bit. And just a little bit, I will pray together. And so I want you to pray together. It's not about the word of God, but it's about the word of God. And I know what Sam Paul mentioned this already, that the earth is going to remember the possessions. And if you want to do that, those are not going to do that. That's a way of wanting to go somewhere. If you have that opportunity, or if it's a specific organization, you want to learn your work, it's a knowledge of what you want to know. And it's going to take place together every part of the world at this time, 30 minutes earlier this year. So it should be at 10:30, and it's going to be at 10 o'clock this year. And we'll need some folks here early to help us with the chairs that we can set up and all that kind of stuff. And so I hope you'll make your plans to be here and invite folks to be there. And we really try to, and so why we have that great report from the staff of our church. So we usually have 3-4-5 people at this together. And I really want to make an opportunity for the community to come. And number one, hear the gospel. Because the gospel is very expensive and it's a very specific government. But we normally encourage the community to get involved and to be there. And not many people say, I don't care if they're being Christian. They can sit there and say, well, I don't want to do that. Why not be part of my community? Why not start a community and say, hey, let's set the rules of law for you to come up and have a community. Let it be. You know, not something that's being that they want to come up, but it's something that The Bible says, and he called to all of you without respect to persons, judging the poor with every man's word. That's the time of your children and your view. For as much as you know, that you probably need your productive things and silver and gold from your grand conversations to see by the vision of your father. But with the precious blood of Christ, as a plan without lunch, without song. The marriage for one man, before the foundation of the world, was manifested to me the last time for you. Who are men, you the living God, that raised him up from the dead, and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be down. See, you have purified your souls and obtained the truth of your spirit. But the unfeigned love of the brethren, seeing that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. We are in our trouble, see, so many trouble by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is the grass, and all glory of the land is the flower of the grass. The grass withereth, and the flower fadeth. Grass withereth and the flower thereof falleth away, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. Look back at the book of Genesis, verse 21. Look at verse 21, where the Bible tells us that in the end of the verse, that your faith and hope might be in God. That your faith and hope might be in God. What's the word? Well, if you go back to verse 5, verse 6, you'll find this. Where can be greater rejoice? So now, for instance, if there be indeed, here are heaviness of manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith may much more precious than gold and perishable, though it be tried with fire, might be found under the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So he's saying in the midst of the trial that you're going through, in the midst of the circumstances that you're given, the natural temptations, these trials, these tests, don't confuse it. It's not God giving you in front of your to it. He talked about your faith test. I mean, you have your faith test. It's very free and it's very surprising. I have your faith test today. Right, exactly. This week, right, exactly. He said, in the midst of all that, he says in verse number 21, that your hope, that your faith in God might be God. In other words, Peter's right here. He's saying, I want you to know that in the midst of all this, you can trust the Lord. In the midst of whatever it is, you can know that you can trust God. That your faith and hope God is not only the object of our faith. He said last week that the object of our faith must be bigger than the problem that we face. Why? Must have God bigger than anything that we face. And so when we look at this process, this response, how to respond during a difficult season, I want to review very quickly that you bring up the earth, but then also to tell them how to respond during a difficult season. I think we're saying that everything that God leads us to has a spiritual purpose. Everything that God leads us to has a spiritual purpose. And the spiritual purpose is this, that we be blind. That's what Christ desires. Everything he does, he draws us to himself, and we read it like that, we respond like him. That would be why Christ. There's a spiritual purpose. But sometimes in our life, we miss that purpose. What is God trying to teach me to God? What is it that happens to the Lord? You know, all of us that is a child, what is a child on the church of God? You know, sometimes spiritually, even if you're a Christian, you don't understand why God is doing what he's doing. You know, therefore, we can respond to this child. When something happens that we don't like, we don't get out of pain. It doesn't go the way we expect it to go. We can sometimes solve our feet, why, and that kind of way. And sometimes that happens because we don't understand what God is doing. And sometimes we have to be taught, hey, you need to grow up. You need to grow up, we need to understand it. God, that's part of what we're starting from the process is the starting point of your Christian journey. It's where you begin to not just hear the word, but do it. You begin to apply the truth of God for your life. He says, sometimes we don't always understand what God is doing. But please understand this, that everything God does is for his spiritual purpose. We say also, when we consider these thoughts of responding to difficult seasons, we say, first of all, difficult seasons, we must learn to be grateful. That's hard to do, isn't it? The Bible says this, in everything. He did not say for everything. For everything. Did not say that there are some things that have happened. That's not what the Bible says. It does not say for everything. It says in everything. What's the difference? The child of God, no matter what they're going through, no matter how many leaders in your car, no matter how many cars go out, no matter how many unexpected bills show up, the child of God always has something to be thankful for. He has everything. I am looking and says, God, I know it's like how this is going to be much better to see the master. In everything, it is. So we talk about being grateful. Well, that goes against our flesh, doesn't it? It goes against our flesh. But it feeds in Jesus, it feeds the Spirit of our flesh. And so we have to learn to be grateful during difficult seasons. And so we talk about where we're grateful. We learn this. Verse 17. We learn this. We're being grateful for God's compassion. We're being grateful for our conversion. We're being grateful for specific protection. He says God has been working to bring you to a place where you understand how much he loves you, how much he cares about you. So he said, first of all, we're difficult seasons. We must be grateful. No person on earth has more reason to be grateful, have a grateful spirit, than the Christian who's a Christian. If you have a grateful spirit, it's not supposed to be something that is success while you're at church. Right? Amen. Yeah, I'm grateful to church because I've got a lot of happiness. I don't have to be grateful.
Thank you.
He said, you are changed by being taken music. I love what you see. This is precious love. So the end world, he said, you are changed because of what Jesus did. He said, you are changed because of how Jesus responded. Verse 33, how Jesus responded when you did it to him. That's what changed. This Christian life is not what you're saying. What's going on with your tone? What's going on with your attitude? If you understand that the grace that you experience, you get better. Why do you get wise from God's?
Amen.
God's saying.
Amen.
You'll be born again, not of what was taught by you, but because of what Jesus did. And if Jesus was willing to take a chair, who was not deserving to walk to the Father and the Spirit, the Christians. They're almost going to deal with us all. And in our flesh, we won't walk to them. Right? Yeah, sometimes we can't work through that. But when we look at the Word of God, and we look at the text here, verse number 22. And then those teachers are going to be first, I'm going to show you the pattern. What's the fact? This is one thing to do with one thing. And we purify our souls to tell the truth through the Spirit. That's what we're saying. Your actions ought to imitate the Holy Spirit. Not to imitate Jesus. Not to imitate the Christian message. Not to imitate. to be so the same, the mistakes that I make as a preacher. You know, if you let people talk on them, they'll tell on themselves. If you let them talk on them, they'll tell on themselves. I love young churches from all ages. Because I spent about 30 years on that, just like it. In your Christian mind, you're more pure. You're becoming better. great knowledge and speak of it. Why? Because the Bible teaches us that our repentance is of the Lord. The more of your time is living, the less of your darkness. I pray for your help. For help to say the right thing. Help to do the right thing. That takes this. That causes us to be disciplined, spiritually healthy for us. That's why I'm not eating all kinds of food, not drinking all kinds of treasure, not putting things in your body that are not hurt you. Being disciplined is spiritually healthy for you. In other words, you don't have to always say what you think you want to say, what you say, what you say, what God says it. Everybody has to do this. So I pray for you to come with help. Thank you. when he said that. And he was more than sad that he called it. And most people are working in that empty. He could get out of the work of it. He got it all business and all these things that many times. I said, hey, I'm just going to talk to you. I have too much to say.
Thank you.
other people see what we want people to see. But there is no problem in marriage without being famous. There is no problem in marriage without being different and compatible. There is no problem in marriage without being famous. It will be precious. There's no problem that can't be fixed. There's no spirit in a person that can't be changed. That's just the land. That's just the land. That's just the land. You know, the way you are supposed to God, watching you right, trusting on the promises, that's not the ability to go on being changed. There's no spirit in a man. There's nothing that cannot be forgiven. I can forgive anything, but I cannot forgive that. That's not my place. I can get over certain things, but I can't get over that. That's not my place. It's just actually being here. You don't have to go. I'm not preaching this one time. I'm just saying, I'm trying to say what Jesus said.
Amen.
You can obey the truth. Obey the truth.
Amen.
That's Thank you.